It's never been taught that way, although it's you know, continued to be some kind of heresy that makes its way into teaching, if not just subliminally. What's up, everybody? Welcome back to the podcast. On this podcast, I answer your questions. You email me podcast@grangersmith.com and we walk through it like we're just having a conversation. And the conversation could really be about anything. Life, love, the Bible. Ask me anything and I'm going to answer it like we're friends and we're trying to talk through something. That's always what this podcast has been. And what I'm doing now for the second week in a row is I'm taking a collection of the most popular questions that gets asked on this podcast all of the time. Instead of answering them individually over and over again, I'm going to, for the second, like last week was eschatology. It was like the end of times. I get asked that all the time. So I thought I would just react to a few videos and give you my thoughts on the end of times. This week, I'm going to do something similar. I'm going to answer a question that comes in all the time, and that is, should Christians cuss? I get that quite a bit, and I think probably that there's a good reason I get that quite a bit, and probably because if you go back over the last decade or more, two decades of my music, you hear curse words in there, and it's like, hey, Granger, now here you are all into the Bible. Is it okay for Christians to cuss or to listen to songs with curse words in them? So you know what? I think that's a great question. And because I get it all the time, I'm probably not going to answer every individual one because they're all pretty much just like I just said. So instead, let's use this episode and let's walk through that question. And Ant-Man has now put together a few videos. I think we have two videos here. So I'll start with this. I'll watch these videos a little bit. Pause, react, and use that as kind of a platform to discuss this topic with. And then I'll give you my own opinion after we walk through these videos. So this is the first one. Let's hit play.
I have a question for you, and yeah. I'm just really curious your opinion on it. What do you think about cussing?
Cussing?
Yeah. What is your take on it?
Yeah, so the reason why it doesn't affect my heart too much is because I know my God doesn't judge, like swearing like that. And mind you, like, yes, I do. I have to change now. Okay, let me rephrase this. I have to change now because God put me in a place for me to be speaking. And I'm realizing that I have to be better and more diligent with my tongue. Because if I'm not, then I'm showing that I'm not disciplined. Therefore, it gives room for the devil to come and just move my tongue right in his direction.
I'm going to pause here, and I'm just going to say that I will definitely address this idea of God judging, or other people judging. We'll deal with that, but I'm going to wait a little bit longer. I'll keep seeing what he's got to say here.
So yes, I have to be obedient on the tongue. Now, when I swear, if I say bullshit, like, to me, I don't see my God looking at me in the same way that other people think my God is looking at me. Because in the scripture says, do not curse your neighbor. Now, cursing isn't like F this, F that, because an F word here can mean something in a different language, right? Right. It's your intent on how you're using it. I think there's a difference, even with my own child, if I'm looking at my child and he stubs his toe as a four-year-old, and he goes, oh, f-, like that. To me, I'm laughing, like, oh, shit. Like, you shouldn't say that. Versus my son out in the street being like, I'm a you up and I'm gonna blah 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 to somebody. I'm like, whoa, that's gonna come with some repercussions, my man. Like, you can't talk like that. Mm-hmm. So I think
let me stop it right here. So what we're going to deal with eventually on this episode as well is that there's a sliver of agreement I have with him here, and that is that Jesus is looking on the heart. In fact, that's when he comes in and we see this profound Sermon on the Mount that we read in Matthew. And when he starts talking to the Pharisees and the religious people, and what he's doing is he's saying, you think you're following the law, and you think you're doing good by following the law. For instance, you think you're doing good by not murdering somebody. But did you know that you hate your brother in your heart and you're murdering them? You think you're doing good by not committing adultery. But did you know that you just look at a woman with lust and you've committed adultery in the heart? So Jesus is always after the heart. And he's always saying, look, it's not what you do. It's your heart posture towards it. So the reason Jesus was doing this is to point out that we are a lot more sinful, that we are a lot worse off than we think we are on the outside, just because we act a certain way. Look how good I am. Look, I'm doing all the right things. I'm checking all the boxes. And Jesus goes, it's a lot worse than you think. I'm looking at the heart. So in relation to this, there's a sliver of truth in here if I go up to a guy in Russia, right? And I write out a four-letter bad word in English and I say, read this. And he's like, he doesn't know what it means and he reads it. Oh, it's not like, oh, that's horrible. You just said that word. Obviously, he has no idea what that means. So his heart posture is completely clean in that instance. But what this guy's saying, what George is saying, is a little different than that. He's actually saying the words and saying there's a different context of saying the words. Let's keep going here.
Thing is, like, where's your intent with it? Like, if for example, if I'm talking to some new Christians and they don't really get God, and I'm talking to them about being perfect, and now I'm watching them tune out, but then I go, but listen, it's fucking hard. And then they go, wait, what? You're like me. Oh, so you're not holier than thou. Mm-hmm. You're not perfect, obviously not, because you're swearing. Sometimes I use it as a relatability, like I speak in their language. It's hard to talk to somebody if you can't understand them. And so I wasn't really too quick to fix my tongue.
I don't think that that's necessary. And if he's truly saying, like, I'm doing whatever it takes to be relatable, I don't think that's what he means. I think he's just trying to be cool and fit in. And he might have a good intention of why he wants to fit in. But I think the better argument is, you're so zealous for your God and you're so obedient and yet joyful and yet happy and yet understanding. And I think that's a better way to be relatable than, man, I'm just like a guy, just like one of you guys. And I also got this God thing going on. I don't think that's as inspiring as he thinks it might be. Let's continue here.
Because I tell people all the time, they look at me as a preacher. I ain't no preacher, dude. I'm a man who fears God and loves to talk.
Yes, you are, if you're speaking on a platform.
You're a preacher. You have a massive platform.
Yeah. Thank you.
If it takes you in the direction of that, then that's great. But to me, it's like my heart was like, I like talking to people that don't know who God is at all. Mm-hmm. And like bringing them, I'm trying to be a fisher of men, right? And I might talk like a sailorman. And that's...
Don't do that. No, I wouldn't go there. That's like a silly cultural analogy. Fishermen and sailors, you know, they're both on water and they should both be able to cuss, right? Like I wouldn't go there.
Swears. Like if you listen to any sailor, they're like, oh, he cusses like a sailor. Like this is the men that Jesus chose. Like you think Peter was walking around with no filthy mouth? Like he was. It took him a bit.
We don't know that.
To like rein it in and be disciplined. I'm 31 years old and I just started. I guarantee you when I'm like 40, I'm probably not going to be talking the same way that I'm talking.
Yeah.
That's an interesting argument. He realizes it's probably not helpful. It's probably not encouraging. It's probably not uplifting. But I still got to get it out of my system for the next 10 years or so. And then it'll probably be totally out of my system. He knows the argument that he's making. So he's already kind of feeling a change. He's already kind of feeling a tug. And no one's even talked to him about it. He's convincing himself already. This is interesting. Let's keep going.
But it doesn't make me toss and turn at night. There's a lot of things that make me toss and turn at night. Mm-hmm. That's just honestly just not one of them for me right now.
We used to make fun of the Christians.
We did. We made fun of people who didn't cuss.
Oh, you're such a holier-than-now Christian. Wow, F this. We truly can't even say it.
It's been probably, I don't know how long, that I can't get an F word out of my mouth. It physically can't come out of my mouth. And you know what? Like,
she said something that made it's gonna. My wheels are going like crazy.
Let's
now.
Go.
Yeah.
What?
When you said it made me cringe, I never really pictured making anybody cringe from my mouth. And if I'm talking about God and I make them cringe,
yeah,
that's a problem.
I think of the scripture. Sorry, Ara. I think of the scripture that said.
So, look at his face. Look at his face right here where I paused it. I love how he said the wheels are turning. And this is very interesting to watch. As I kind of recognize that as he's kind of explaining his best way to justify why he does speak like a sailor, like he said. And then as his own personal justification starts to kind of crumble a little bit, look at his face. And I want to see where this goes.
I'm sorry. Well, I just want to tell you one scripture. I think it's in James. It's like, can fresh water and salt water both flow out of the same spring? How can you love God and curse anybody with the same mouth?
I saw that as cursing a man, though.
But it's,
like, even my own enemies, they don't even know, but I plant them flowers in their fields.
Right.
He's justifying here again.
Right. So I was reading. So you know the moment where Peter denies Jesus three times, right?
Before
the
rooster crows, yeah.
Yeah. And I can pull it up because I'm paraphrasing, but it says something. So three times people come up to him. Do you know Jesus? You were just with him. I saw you with him. You're a Jew, like you have to be with him. And he says three times, no, I don't know him. No, I don't know him. The third time it says that Peter curses and says, I do not know this man. So in the moment where he was trying to separate himself from Jesus and no longer identify as a follower of Jesus, he cursed. Yeah. He used some sort of foul language. Mm-hmm. And that's what really got me in saying when I do use foul language, as annoying as it is, when I do, I'm separating myself from the character of Jesus.
Yeah, that's how I felt.
I want to catch his face again.
And I didn't want this to happen to me. Okay, you know what? I'm singing along to songs and I'm a loser. I'm skipping over the F word.
We do the edited F-word version now.
It's ridiculous.
But I was feeling the separation from God when I was living in sin, when I was, you know, sexually active before marriage, when
I want to notice too that what they're talking about is not just speaking curse words. They're also talking about listening to it or hearing it or watching it in a movie or listening to it in a song. But I'm very interested, probably more than the conversation itself, I'm more interested in George and how he is reacting to it. And I think we should all watch and see what is working inside of George right now. That's the guy with the beanie cap. What is happening to him? It's interesting. Let's keep watching. And I'm going to try to get past these girls talking here. Let's go back to George. Here he is.
Did you guys talk about my swearing behind closed doors? Is that something that you guys wanted to fix on me?
No, not fix on you.
No, but notice it. Did notice it.
Is it something that challenged you guys when you guys heard my stuff?
Yeah, it was, we didn't talk about it as if we were going to bring it up at all, but we were watching like some clips together and I noticed that like you cuss on the podcast. And you know, it's funny, is our first episode, I'm pretty sure we said a couple cuss words.
Yeah, we did actually.
I know on the second one, I spelt out a cuss word because I just didn't, we weren't living, you know what I mean? We didn't know. And honestly, we didn't really care yet.
And no, we didn't say, oh, let's bring this up. But I did notice that. And because I was like that, that's what we did. So I was just, you know.
I make a vow that today's the last day, I swear. Yeah, you guys challenged me.
I have chill bumps.
I'm probably going to mess up a lot.
It's okay.
But I'm going to go get a band and write it on my hand every day until I master it.
Wow. Okay, so that's what I thought this was. This is where I thought this was leading, and I was hoping he was going to do that. So what we've witnessed here, and I'm going to try to find a spot I could pause on his face because I like his face. There we go. So what we're seeing, and to be honest, I haven't followed this guy, George Janko, I think it's his name. This is the first video I've seen from him. But I tell you why I know he's a brother. And it's a beautiful thing because what's happening to him is repentance. And a lot of times we Christians talk about repentance and the Bible commands repentance. It's necessary. Repentance is necessary as a human response to the saving grace of God. And so what's happened with George is he's defending it he's giving reasons why he thinks that cussing or using a foul mouth is beneficial in his quote-unquote ministry because it's helping to relate and God's looking at the heart, not at the words. But as these girls unpack a pretty good defense for keeping a clean mouth, we'll call it that term, he starts to break down, and it's actually visible on this video. And it's really neat to see, because we're watching in real time on this video repentance as it's happening. And then the way I know he's a brother, and the way you know Christ is in this man and the Holy Spirit is working in him, as far as we could tell from one video. But humans don't do this. This is not normal for a human. And I believe this is his show. I believe this is his podcast. So it would be like someone coming on my podcast and challenging me with something that I had just made my own defense for, so that I could keep up with what I'm defending that I think is right. And someone that's a guest challenging me, and humans don't do well in this kind of situation, especially on our own platforms in front of our own people. We don't do well. Our pride kicks in and all the defenses go up and we go, man, this is something we're all, you got your thing. Don't be holier than me. Don't come judging me and on my show. You know, this is, and even if you don't say it out loud, that's what you're thinking. And you could see that through body language. That's not what's happening to this guy, George. His body language goes into submission. He starts, look at his face right here on this screenshot. His eyes are turned. He's thinking. He's in deep thought, and he's backpedaling, and he's turning away. He's changing his mind. Literally, you could see repentance in his face right here. He's changing his mind about sin and turning instead to God. And by the end of this video, he says, I'm making a vow right now that I'm going to stop cussing. Oh, man, it gives me chills. It's a beautiful thing. And then he goes on to say correctly, I'm going to mess up, but I don't want to do this anymore. It's basically what he's saying. And so it's the direction. It's not the achievement. It's not the destination of where we're going to defeat sin. Instead, it's a change of course. It's a change of direction away from ourselves and our pride and our sin. And changing course as if you're in a boat and you're completely changing the boat and you're turning all the way, you're turning the stern all the way around and you're going the other way. And you're going, listen, I know I'm going to have a tendency to turn back to the old way again, but I don't want to go that way anymore. I want to go this way. I want to go God's way. And as he was rebuked by these other Christians, that's the decision he makes. And that is repentance. And it is beautiful. And so even though we're not even talking about cussing at this point, I think that's a beautiful illustration of repentance. And I also think the idea, the conclusion about cussing is correct. Let's jump into another video, and then I'll give you my thoughts about this. So a long time ago, whenever I started GrangerSmith.com, I think the furthest thing from my mind was one day I would be selling things online in an online store. Like Yee apparel, that was the furthest thing from my mind. But as things evolved and, you know, things started progressing in my career, I started selling t-shirts and hats and koozies and music. And that eventually led to Yee apparel. And everything became easy when we started using Shopify. Now, what is Shopify? Shopify is the global commerce platform that helps you sell at every stage of your business, from the very beginning to your peak. Whether you're just selling like scented soaps or outdoor apparel like Yee, Shopify helps you sell everywhere, from their all-in-one e-commerce platform to their in-person POS system. Wherever or whatever you're selling, Shopify's got you covered. They also help turn your browsers into buyers with the internet's best converting checkout, 36% better on average compared to the other leading commerce platforms. So you could sell more with less effort thanks to Shopify Magic, your AI-powered all-star. I'm just not a tech-savvy person. And the last thing I really want to do is to start figuring out how to set up an online store so that people could buy a t-shirt from us. Thankfully, that's where Shopify comes in and takes over that aspect of our business and just makes it super easy. And it's not just us, though. Shopify powers 10% of all e-commerce in the entire U.S. They're also in 175 different countries. Plus, Shopify's award-winning help is there to support your success every step of the way, because businesses that grow, grow with Shopify. Sign up for a $1 per month trial period at shopify.com/Granger, all lowercase. Go to shopify.com/Granger now to grow your business no matter what stage you're in. Shopify.com/Granger. you know, if you want to get a hold of me sometime, maybe have me make a video for your significant other or for your sibling or your child or your cousin or your friend, I could do that right here on my phone and make a video for them. If you go to cameo.com/Granger Smith, I could do that right now. Again, that is cameo, cameo.com/Granger Smith. Okay, this next video that Ant-Man found, this is going to, that first one was just a kind of a general idea about cussing itself. Now, this one is going to dive deeper into what is cussing. In fact, the title of this that Ant-Man put is The Hypocrisy of Cussing. What does that even mean? We're talking about how this all flows from the heart. And then I'm going to give you, I have a few notes here on my phone. I'm going to read you my thoughts that I wrote down. Well, I just wrote down some verses. So we'll discuss after we check out this video.
And I do think you can...
Which one of these things... And as a matter of fact, this is a question. What do you think about this? Okay. You have two different sentences. You have someone that goes... If I were to look at my brother and say, "You're an idiot and you're never going to be anything in life,"
that's awful.
That versus if I looked at my brother and said, "I love you so effing much." And there's a two part question. Okay, so which one of those do you think?
The video skipped just a little bit, but he said, "What's the difference? What is better, telling your brother you're an idiot and I don't like you, basically, or I love you so effing much, but actually using the word?" That's his point here.
God would be like, "Yeah." Absolutely not.
I don't think God would co-sign either statement.
Right, so right. Now watch this. If do you think your answer would be the same if I said it was you're an idiot and you're never going to be anything in life, or I love you so freaking much, dude? I think that the conversation then becomes, so does God have an issue with the heart or spelling?
Okay, so now he's making the argument for, instead of the actual F word, what about freaking? Like, could you say I love you so freaking much? And that way you're avoiding the actual F word and you've replaced it with something else. Is that okay? That's his question.
Because freaking means the same thing as the F word.
It does, but it doesn't have the same impact.
It doesn't have the same impact.
And
for
so
sure.
Sometimes, and this is hard because it's not fair. Sometimes you are judged by your impact and not your intent.
Yeah. The only reason I'm pushing back is because the church, like Christians, we have these filler words mm-hmm. that don't actually have any meaning except for to be the filler word for a cuss word.
Totally right.
So that means
maybe we should stop saying those words too, though.
That is my exact point.
I'm down.
So my point is that, yo, if we're either about to wipe the whole board, let's get rid of heck, dang, frick. Let's get rid of crap. Let's take it all out.
I'm down.
Or green light all of it. You know what I'm saying?
I still think some things are just going to be felt different. Like some things 100%. Are just going to
impact. And like I said, you know.
Okay, so he's making the argument that if we're going to have words that replace the actual cuss words, is it okay to say them because they have less of an impact? So that this is the discussion is it the actual word? Kind of like I said earlier, if I wrote out a four-letter word and gave it to a Russian guy and he spoke it and he had no idea what it meant, what would that mean for him? Would he be sinning in that? Of course not. Like I said, with Sermon on the Mount, Jesus is getting to the heart. Jesus did this through his entire ministry. He wanted the heart. He was dealing with the heart. And from the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks, Jesus says. And so as you speak, you are speaking the overflow of what's in your heart. If you want to get to know someone, listen to them speak. If you want to know the heart of a man or a woman, stay around long enough and listen to them speak, and you will hear the overflow of their heart. That's what Jesus means by that. And I think that's the argument that these guys are making in this video.
Saying this is just a lot of it just for to go and think about and have you actually think about the way that you consider people.
Yeah.
Because I know people that would say things like, if you cuss, you're not a Christian, period. That's a silly statement because
that's the part we need to discuss as well. For someone to say, if you cuss, you're not a Christian. Guess what? It's without me even getting into that. The previous video made a great point on that. The guy, George Janko. I think, I don't know, but I think that he is a brother. He is a Christian, and he was cussing at the beginning of the video, and then by the end of it, he was not. So it would not be a fair judgment at all to say, because of what you say, I could judge you today and tell you whether you are or not a Christian. That's a different discussion, but I think the argument could be made already that that first video proved that wrong.
You cuss. By God's standards, you cuss all day long.
Yeah, it's a tricky one, man, because it's deemed what's appropriate by a society. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? It's deemed what's appropriate in different times and space. Different words were more appropriate in different times of space. And like here's an example. Did you know that like spaz is considered derogatory to specific people that have
Tourette's?
Not Tourette's, it's another one. But like in the UK, like you can't, like spaz is not appropriate.
And that's another thing.
You know what I mean? So it's like, there's, it's just, yeah, exactly. It's just a lot.
That's another thing that I think plays into it is like here, certain words are cuss words. Somewhere else, yes, they're not. Yes. And so then.
Okay. I don't know where this video is necessarily going. And I don't know if I actually need more ammo to make this argument, because now they're getting into, once again, the heart of the matter. Where is your heart in the situation? That's what Jesus wants to know. So, first, we should address this idea of people, the holier than now idea, like, oh, you're just being holier than, what is that phrase? Holier than, hold it, than thou, holier than thou. That's what people say. Oh, you're holier than thou. That's what the last video said too. It's just critical. It's critical for us to know that we are saved by grace through faith. This is not our own doing. This is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no man may boast. Ephesians 2:8-9. And it's critical to understand that there is nothing we do or don't do that saves us. So stopping cussing will not make you a Christian. Stop stealing, and that will not make you a Christian. Stop committing adultery, that will not make you a Christian. We have to understand that this idea of being a good person makes you a Christian, or that being a good person gets you an invitation to heaven, is absolute heresy, and it's completely wrong. It's never been taught that way, although it's you know, continued to be some kind of heresy that makes its way into teaching, if not just subliminally, through our minds and through our teaching and through our understanding and through our living. So if you were to ask the average person on the street, how do you get into heaven? A common answer is, I don't know, you got to be a good person. Well, the Bible is very clear, first of all, that no one is good. No, not even one, Isaiah says, through the inspiration of God. And then Paul will say that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, Romans 3:23. So no one is good, and all have sinned and fall short of his glory. All have fallen short of our invitation to heaven. It's not happening. We've already messed that up. So whether or not you cuss or not, or you cuss a lot or a little or a medium amount or none of that has anything to do with your right standing with God. The only way you have right standing with God is through Jesus, through his final work, his finished work on the cross as a substitution for the crime punishment that you deserved, right? And in exchange, you are seen righteous in exchange for your faith in him, your belief in him, and your repentance, like we saw from George in the last video. It's that you turn away from yourself, you go to God and you go, God, I can't do it. I'm turning away from myself and I'm changing my course to you, saying, I trust you and what you have done because I have fallen short. Have mercy on me, a sinner. That's the only standing we have with him, is what Jesus did for us. God, the Son incarnate in flesh, coming into this world for humanity to suffer in it, in the humanity that he created, which is just wild, to come and suffer in it so that we could be reconciled back to God, who we broke our relationship with through our own sin. So all of that is the truth, and this cussing thing is irrelevant to that. So to be able to say, I know he's a Christian or not because of what he says, is wrong. But it could be an indication of a heart that is still corrupted, if that makes sense. Because out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So you can see indications of a healthy tree by its fruit. And if a tree has bad fruit, then you can go, okay, this tree might need to be completely torn down, burned, and replanted, right? Which is what God does with us through conversion. We become a new creation, a new tree that now bears good fruit instead of bad fruit. So you can make an argument that you can get a lot of information from someone and how they speak, but that's not what we're talking about either. We're talking about, is it okay for Christians to cuss? I think that's the topic at hand. And I want to go for answers to this. I want to go straight to the Bible itself. And I made some notes here. And so I just want to go through a couple of verses and do just some light commentary on them. And some of the stuff was already talked about in the previous video. Ephesians 4, 29. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may be beneficial, that it may benefit those who listen. So that George was making the argument, well, yeah, this is building them up because I'm relating to them. Okay, well, then let's go to Colossians 3:8. But now you must also rid yourself of all such things as these: anger, rage, malice, slander, and filthy language from your lips. So now George has already lost his argument to Colossians 3:8. James 3:10, I believe that was mentioned in this video, previous video. Out of the same mouth come praise and cursing. My brothers and sisters, this should not be. Proverbs 18:21, the tongue has the power of death, the power of life and death, and those who love it will eat its fruit. Matthew 12:36 and 37. But I tell you that everyone will have to give an account on the day of judgment for every empty word they have spoken. For by your words you will be acquitted, and by your words you will be condemned. Well, that is very interesting, and we have to also remember that we're saved by grace through faith. So you will be judged by everything that you do, and the only way you'll be set free is if your righteousness is found in Jesus through your faith in him and not on your own. So you're in deep trouble if you're out on your own trying to hope you're going to get into heaven, because Jesus is saying, hey, you're already condemned. Ephesians 5:4 says, nor should there be obscenity, foolish talk, or coarse talking, which is out of place, but rather thanksgiving. So he's encouraging Christians already converted, already have the ability to repent like George did. And what happens is when these verses are taking somebody that's already a Christian, and it's encouraging them to walk in the light, basically. And you can't tell a non-believer this because they don't have that ability to walk. Instead, they need the gospel so that they could, that tree that they are, could be torn down and thrown into the fire and reborn into a new tree that now is capable of bearing good fruit through the work of Jesus, through the ability that they now have empowered by Jesus. So those Christians that we're talking about, that's why that distinction is so important. So Christians now have the ability to hear this, to hear Ephesians 5:4 and go, ah, man, my wheels are turning. Kind of like George said, man, I feel that. I've been messing. I've been doing that coarse joking. I've been doing that foolish talk thing. I got to change, right? So let's move on. Proverbs 15:1. A gentle answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger. Colossians 4:6, let your conversation always be full of grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone. 1 Peter 3:10, for whoever would love life and see good days must keep their tongue from evil and their lips from deceitful speech. Psalm 19:14, may these words of my mouth and this meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight, Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Yeah, that's really good stuff. And once again, these are, when Christians hear these, I've said this before in a message. It's like when you become a butterfly, if you're a caterpillar, right? And you've become a brand new butterfly, and other butterflies, more wise, mature butterflies, come up to you and you go, they say to the young butterfly, the old ones say, hey man, you know, you don't have to be walking around with these caterpillars eating these leaves anymore. There's something way better. It's called nectar. And it's over there on the other side of the garden. And then the new butterfly is like, well, how am I supposed to get to the other side? And the older butterfly says, you see those things you got on your sides now, those legs? Those are wings. You can fly. You know, so sometimes it takes for a new Christian or a Christian that just hasn't been well discipled to hear these words from a more wise Christian and words from the Bible like this that rebuke them. They go, oh, I can fly. It's a beautiful thing. So here's another thing we've been talking about. Should you say darn or heck or dang it? Here's another one. Listen to this. Dadgummit. And you've probably heard me say dadgummit. That's what my dad said all the time. Dadgummit. What does that mean? Where did that come from? Well, I was thinking about this today before the podcast. Take the D and the G and swap them. And now say it. And see what that comes out to be. You could see what that replaced. Dadgummit. Switch the D and the G and see what it replaced. So it's the same heart position. You're saying the same thing. Jesus says this in Matthew 5:37. Simply let your yes be yes and your no be no. Anything beyond this comes from the evil one. So like this guy on this video was making this argument, if you're going to tell your brother, I love you so freaking much, let your yes be yes and your no be no. Let that be enough. You don't have to exaggerate anything, right? So the heart position matters. And I think the darns and the dangits and the dadgummits actually do matter. And this is personal sanctification for anyone listening that says that and they're a Christian. Don't think I'm telling you you're condemned or you're not a Christian or you're in sin. I'm saying that as a rebuke and as something to think about from the overflow of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. I think these are things that if you hear it a certain way and you hear me saying this, you might, like me, say, oh, maybe I shouldn't say any of it. For the 10th time on this podcast, not because you're earning righteousness or because you're obtaining your own salvation from what you do or say. That's already a gift from God. As you turn from your sin and put your faith in Jesus and his work on the cross, I'll say that again. But because of the abundance of the heart, when Jesus is in your heart and you're filled with the Holy Spirit and you want so badly just to show everyone your love for Jesus because of the way he loved you first. In the abundance of that, in the overflow of that, kind of like you take that Mentos and you drop it in a Coke and the Coke just overflows. It's like that, from that overflow, you go, Lord, I want to do all these things. I don't want to say anything that might be hurtful or discouraging to someone. I only want to be someone that's uplifting to others. I only want to be loving to others. And so I want to watch my tongue. I want to keep it from becoming evil. I want to make sure that everything is clean coming out of my mouth, right? So that might be, when you hear this video, where you end up. And then I love that the girl in that one video brought up this Matthew 26:74, talking about Peter as he's denying Jesus. It says, then he began to call down curses and swore to them, I don't know the man. Immediately the rooster crowed. I'm reading out of the NIV for that because I think it's an interesting translation for that part. And I think those girls had a good point that in this instance with Peter, as he's separating himself from Jesus, that's when he curses. It represents a separation. And so as you hear this, What I'm talking about, this term is called sanctification. That's a churchy word. But this is the process of becoming more and more like Jesus. As his spirit indwells us, it starts to convict us in certain things. And people get convicted in different ways. For instance, I've gotten convicted with college football. As I'm watching it and my emotions rage and my spirit pours out onto this game, and I've realized over the years, man, I think this is idolatry for me. I think I'm worshiping college football. I think that's becoming a sin for me, and I should probably back down. That's the conviction of the Holy Spirit. No, I don't think a normal man would say that. But because of the conviction within me, the Spirit goes, hey, watch yourself. Watch yourself. And so when I say, dadgummit, and I've said that for so, I mean, my character Donnie says that. It's like his thing, right? So when I say that now, and my spirit goes, watch yourself. Not because I'm falling out of the faith, but hey, you're becoming more and more like Jesus. And in that process, you're going to be reminded and convicted of certain things. And so to answer this question for people that have emailed me 1,000 times saying, Granger, where do you stand on this? Because you have songs that have cussing in them. And my answer to all of those people is that I am sorry. And you're right. And if I was going to make a song today, I wouldn't dare do that. I wouldn't dare put those words in those songs. And if you, I don't know if y'all notice, but the people that have gone to my concerts and they watched this whole thing happening to me, the sanctification was happening in real time on the stage in front of everybody. You might have noticed that words like City Boy Stuck, I believe, is one of the ones that there's a lot of those songs where the word was hell. Oh yeah. The word in City Boy Stuck was, hell no, not me. And that started bothering me. And so it became, heck no, not me. That was the best I could do. Now, the more I'm sanctified, I'm like, I don't even think heck isn't even right. Because that's just replacing the word and it's coming out of the same heart. So you probably noticed that there were a lot of words that changed. And there were songs that I never sang, like Damn Guitar. I never sang that song. I was just too convicted. I wrote the song a long time ago. And it was in the movie Moonrise without the words, though. You notice that? It was in the movie Moonrise without the words. And I never sang that song live. And it always bothered me. The song Damn Straight always bothered me. Not when I recorded it, obviously. But as I was sanctified more and more, and as I got deeper into the word, and as the Holy Spirit was tugging at me in a lot of different things, conforming me, molding me. It's like I was, when I was put into the fire, really, starting with losing Riv, and then what happened to me later, as I was in the fire of this, the metal that I was, as corrupted and corroded as I was beginning to melt and melt and melt until it was just molten liquid metal. That's how far down I was melted. And when I reached that point of complete melted metal, that's when the Lord was able to start working. That's when the maker's hand takes that molten metal and makes it new, turns it into the refinement that it was always intended to be. And as that's happening, and as that refinement happens, it's not always fun. Sometimes it hurts a little bit. You're like, wait, why do I feel bad about saying, darn it? That's weird. You know, you start thinking that you feel so out of place. And you're like, hang on a second. Maybe I've been given the power through the Holy Spirit to change the way I talk. Maybe this is not as big a deal as I think I need to fit into culture by saying cultural things. Maybe it's not a big deal at all. And just like that guy George said, I'm going to mess up a lot. But it's not the destination. It's the shift. It's the change of direction towards a new destination that is the evidence of a believer, of a Christian. So do Christians cuss? That's irrelevant. And the answer is probably yes. But should Christians cuss? I believe that answer is no. And although I wouldn't put judgment on current Christians and say you shouldn't cuss, and I absolutely would not put that judgment on a non-Christian, and I would never say, hey, that word offends me. I'm going to listen to it. And if someone's talking to me and they go, so sorry for the language, I'm going to say, no need to apologize. And in my mind, I'm thinking, you don't have Jesus. So let me tell you the gospel. Don't apologize for your words. I understand. I'll give you grace for that. But for the Christian, if they ask me, I'm going to say, brother, I don't think it is right. And I think you will be sanctified. And I think eventually, just like we saw in that video with George, I think true repentance is right around the corner for you. Love you guys. If you have a question, email podcast@grangersmith.com, and we'll see you next week. Yee-yee. Thanks for joining me on the Granger Smith podcast. I appreciate all of you guys. You could help me out by rating this podcast on iTunes. If you're on YouTube, subscribe to this channel, hit that little like button and the notifications bell so that you never miss any time I upload a video. If you have a question for me that you would like me to answer, email grangersmithpodcast@gmail.com. Yee-yee.